Welcome to St. Paul's today. We're so glad that you've joined us. We invite you to sing with us, to worship with us, to hear the word of the Lord together.
Good morning and welcome again to St. Paul's. It is good to be together in the Lord. It's good for me to be back as well. I've been away for a few Sundays and I am glad to be back worshiping with the St. Paul's family. If you are new or are worshiping with us for the first time, I would encourage you to go to our website, stpaulsottawa.com, and there you can find links for a variety of things that are happening. You can also find a link for a Connect card so that we can be in contact with you and let you know what else is going on. If you have any questions, you could do that through there as well, and we will get back to you as soon as we can. If we've been following the news at all, we know that there has been a tremendous crisis in Beirut, in Lebanon, and Presbyterian World Service and Development is responding to that and is doing so through an organization that the federal government will match funds. So if you are interested in helping with that, I would encourage you, we don't have a link yet, but just Google PWSND or Presbyterian World Service and Development, and you will find the link for that. And Barring that, you can make a donation to St. Paul's. Just make it clear that it is for Beirut, Lebanon, and relief there. Let's pray as we continue to worship. Our loving God, we thank you for all that you are and for all that you have done for us. We bow before you in worship to acknowledge that you are God and you are Lord of all. You are the creator of all things, and in Jesus Christ, you are our Savior. You are present with us wherever we are because your Holy Spirit is with us and is even a part of us. Bless us with your grace. We pray that you would forgive all our sins in Jesus, that you would heal our brokenness in Jesus, and that you would make us new again in Jesus, that we should live for you and bring glory to you. We pray all of this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Join us as we continue to worship.
Good morning and welcome to Family Time. Here at St. Paul's, we care about our families. We care about you, Mom, and you, Dad. And we want to talk today about something that all of us deal with, and that is conflict. We all have conflict in our homes. Every family, whether they look like it or not, fight sometimes. Now, I bet that as a youth, or maybe still, or at some point in your life, you've either played a sport or watched a sport. And one of the things that is really abundantly clear in sports is that there's a referee and there are boundaries. So one of the first things to do when you start to deal with conflict in your family is to find a neutral time in a neutral place. And a neutral time could be a time when everybody's not tired or hungry, just any old time. A neutral place. Don't do this in the kitchen. I find that sometimes we have a lot of our arguments in the kitchen, or whatever your trigger is. Don't talk about conflict in that area. Find a neutral area to talk about the conflict in your home. Now, one of the most important things to do is to be sure in yourself and between you and your spouse what the boundaries are going to be in your family. Sitting down and having that discussion over a cup of coffee in the morning, talking about what in our home, what do we want the boundaries to be for us and for our kids. Now, drawing those boundaries, when you sit down, you have that talk with your kids, it's important. Let me say again, it's really important that you have those kids be a part of that process of setting the boundaries in your family. When you sit down with them, listen to them. Ask them what rules they feel are fair. Ask them to make suggestions. And trust me, it might be very humbling because they might say something that is similar to, well, I think we should make a rule that you shouldn't yell at me anymore. Don't feel you're alone, Mom and Dad. We've all had times in our life when we have yelled. I remember one specific occasion. My son was probably about 14, and I'd asked him to help make supper, and I'd say, can you just cut the onion? And he's like, oh, what do I do with the onion? And I'm like, well, you cut it. And it was the silliest, tiniest thing that exploded into him and I yelling at each other and him ending up with tears coming down his cheeks going, what's a 14-year-old boy supposed to do with an onion? So silly. We can go to a place of yelling and conflict so simply and so, it comes at such strange times. But sitting down with your child and setting what those boundaries will be and giving your child authority, a little bit of authority, to call penalty based on the rules that you set so that it would be okay if you and your child were in a heated argument and your child would have the authority to say, I thought we weren't gonna do this. At the same time, very respectfully saying this to you, but you, when you talk to them, also being very respectful and saying to them when they start yelling or getting into an argumentative space, I thought we weren't gonna do this. What was the plan? What were we gonna do differently? I know, parents, that it is really hard to take your emotion out of arguments. But trust me, from my own personal experience, when you're able to take your emotions out of the equation for those few minutes that you need to deal with a conflict with your child, you will get so much farther ahead. Remember, make some time in a neutral place and a neutral time. Ask your child for input and give them a little bit of authority to be able to call you on it when you are not keeping the rules, and also respectfully to call them on it when they are not keeping the rules. Now, sometimes you're gonna need a referee. A referee is somebody that, if nobody is keeping the rules and things are really going sideways, that you need some extra help. Now, for some people, that's a marriage counselor. Some people, that's a family counselor. Sometimes it's just talking to someone who is a few steps ahead of you in the parenting game, or talking to someone like a family pastor. Remember that there are people in your life, whether they be counselors, pastors, or older friends, who have experienced what you are going through, and they are more than willing to talk with you and to help you to gain even more tools than I have talked about here in helping your family deal with conflict in healthy ways that are edifying and respectful for everyone in the home. I pray that you have a wonderful week this week, that you find things to do with your kids that are fun. Speaking of which, we have started our family vacation Bible school, and we have families in our church. We've had a really good turnout of families that have decided to do family VBS, and we had fun this last week. We did a glow in the dark theme, and everybody got a ton of glow sticks, and they did all kinds of really cool things. They bowled in the dark, they danced in the dark, they made stick men in the dark, they played hopscotch in the dark. There was so many creative ideas. I would love to share some pictures with you. So parents, if you're seeing this, send me some pictures so I can show everybody else the cool things that we're doing. This next week, in Vacation Bible School, we are going to be looking at how sweet Jesus is. And everybody who has a bag for Vacation Bible School will be opening up their special bag. They have an activity to do in there. And on Thursday, meet at 6 o'clock on Zoom, and we will be talking about just how sweet Jesus is. I pray you have a blessed week. God go with you and keep you.
At this point in the service, we would usually have our offering. So we would encourage you, if you are financially able, to continue to give your gifts to the church or a special donation to the disaster relief. Regarding giving during this time of COVID and social distancing can be found on our webpage, and we would encourage you to take a moment and look at that when the service is done. We'll continue now with our worship.
This morning we are reading from Psalm 36. Let's hear God's word. Transgression speaks to the wicked deep in his heart. There is no fear of God before his eyes, for he flatters himself in his own eyes that his iniquity cannot be found out and hated. The words of his mouth are trouble and deceit. He has ceased to act wisely and do good. He plots trouble while on his bed. He sets himself in a way that is not good. He does not reject evil. Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mountains of God. Your judgments are like the great deep. Man and beast you save, O Lord. How precious is your steadfast love, O God. The children of mankind take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light do we see light. Oh, continue your steadfast love to those who know you, to your righteous, to the upright of heart. Let not the foot of arrogance come upon me, nor the hand of the wicked drive me away. There the evildoers lie fallen. They are thrust down, unable to rise. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The sky was clear and blue. It was a perfect day. And a friend, Rob, who had a private pilot's license, looked up into that sky and just had to be up there. So he went and he rented a Cessna 172 and climbed into that sky. There was blue everywhere except for this one big white fluffy cloud. Rob flew around where he lived and worked and saw things that he saw every day from a different perspective at 3,000 feet. And there was that cloud. He flew over to it and began to fly around it, keeping a regulation 500 feet from the cloud. He looked at it and it looked solid, but he knew it was just water vapor. The temptation grew. He wanted to fly through it. Now, his pilot's license was a VFR license. He had to fly visual flight rules, which means he was not allowed to go into a cloud. He had to keep at least 500 feet from any cloud. But the temptation was so strong. There was nobody else in the sky. It was only 3,000 feet. And so he lined himself up to the edge of the cloud to fly through it. He knew from flying around the cloud and his airspeed that it was going to take about 90 seconds, about a minute and a half, to fly through the cloud. Imagine his surprise when he saw sunlight after only about 45 seconds. And imagine his surprise when the Cessna was at a terrible angle of attack, just ready to stall. He'd had no idea what was going on with his plane. A private pilot's license includes instrument flying. And Rob had had that. He knew what to do with instruments, and he knew when he couldn't see properly to fly that he was supposed to follow the instruments. But as he flew into the cloud, he was flying by feel. He looked down at his instruments, but what he saw on his instruments bore no resemblance to what he felt with his senses, what he was experiencing with his senses. So he ignored the instruments and flew by feel. And it was almost a disaster. In that flight, Rob was a fairly experienced pilot. And he rejected the truth that his instruments had displayed to him because it didn't feel right to him. His senses, his perceptions told him something other than what the instruments were telling him. And so he went with what he knew instead of what he was told. Rob chose the familiar and made a really bad mistake. Could have been a deadly mistake, but he was able to stabilize the plane and fly on. And he learned a great lesson that day. Trust your instruments. Fly the truth, even when it feels wrong. The psalm we read today also has two paths, two directions, two choices. Fly by feel or fly by instruments. But it's different in Psalm 36. Now, if you know me and the messages I bring, you know I usually preach from the New International Version of the Bible, that translation, the NIV. But this is one of those passages where the NIV translation is not nearly as good as the other translations. So this morning we are reading from the English Standard Version, the ESV, which has a much better translation. Transgression speaks to the wicked deep in his heart. There's no fear of God before his eyes. For he flatters himself in his own eyes that his iniquity cannot be found out and hated. The words of his mouth are trouble and deceit. He has ceased to act wisely and do good. He plots trouble while on his bed. He sets himself in a way that is not good. He does not reject evil. These first verses of the psalm tell of the way of sin. One who does not follow God's way follows the way of sin. Now, there are different words in the psalm that mean sin. The psalm says transgression, has wickedness, iniquity, and evil. They all amount to the same thing, which is putting oneself at the center of our own universe rather than having God take that place, which is his rightful place. As I was working on this message, I found it difficult to know which word to use. Transgression and wickedness and iniquity sound all so old-fashioned as to barely have any meaning for us today at all. The word sin is a very churchy word, and unfortunately, it is way too often associated only with sexual inappropriateness. The word evil, we understand, but we restrict its use to people and things like Hitler and Pol Pot and the Rwandan genocide and mass murders, extreme examples. That's evil. We would never consider what we do to be evil, even though the Bible says that. Whatever word we choose to use, these verses speak of a life lived without the influence and grace of God. I'm going to use the word sin today, with the understanding that sin is a path that leads away from God. It is a life, it is living a life that rejects or at least ignores God. Sin is an attitude that pushes God off of his throne, off of the throne of our lives, so that we can take that place ourselves. In Psalm 36, we see that the way of sin is a way of self-deception, where one thinks one is free from all that would control or impinge life. But the truth is, when we follow the way of sin, we become so blinded to sin that we don't even notice it. And when we don't notice it, we don't even see how much of a grip it has on us, how much we are in bondage to sin. It is a path that is easy to follow, and it is a path that is a lie. It proclaims freedom, but really, it is only a bondage to sin. When we follow sin, not only are we blinded to sin, but we are also blinded to the true nature of reality. When we're subject to sin, we don't even see true reality. And what is that true reality? The psalmist went on, "Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mountains of God. Your judgments are like the great deep. Man and beast you save, O Lord. How precious is your steadfast love, O God. The children of mankind take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light do we see light." This is the reality, the truest and ultimate reality that we miss when we follow the way of sin. Note that the contrast here is not between the way a sinner lives and the way a righteous person lives. That's not what's going on. The contrast here is between the way of sin and God. That's what's being contrasted here. So here in the Old Testament, even as we are looking at righteousness, we find God's grace. These verses go on to talk about the life of those who turn away from the path of sin and turn toward God. And we might expect a contrast between sinners and righteous people, but that's not what we find here. This is all about God's grace. The psalmist wrote that in God we find refuge. In God we find that we can feast on the abundance that he provides, that we drink from the river of God's delight. When we follow God and live in his grace, we know the great delight and joy of the Lord. The psalm then continues with prayer for God's constant grace and loving care. It is a prayer for care and protection. It is a prayer that we should always live within the grace that God gives to his people. And then wham, verse 12 hits us at the end of the psalm and reminds us that when we refuse to turn from the path of sin, there are consequences. There are consequences to the choices we make, consequences to rejecting truth. Like Rob, flying experienced the consequences of rejecting the truth that his instruments told him and instead going with what he felt, with what his senses were saying to him. There are consequences. This psalm shows the dark background against which the radiant picture of God's grace and love are seen more clearly. It shows a contrast between the way of sin and the way of God. It subtly asks the difficult question about how the reality of sin can be reconciled with belief in the God of righteousness. As we read, we discover that the answer is not found in weighing good and evil on a balance. But the answer is found in our choice of God in faith and making that strong and joyful affirmation of faith in him. This psalm shows the power of what faith is able to attain when we take the risk to trust God in the midst of all the darkness and evil of this world. The risk to trust God, even when our senses and our feelings tell us something different. This psalm presents us with two realities, but I want to be really clear on this. These are not equal but opposite realities. One of these realities is truth in all its fullness, with God as Lord sitting on his throne. The other reality is a lie in which we want to be Lord and we want to sit on the throne. There's a contrast here, but it is not between things of equal value. It is between truth and a lie. The way of sin tells us to believe only in what we can touch with our five senses. The way of sin tells us there's no absolute truth, that we are the ones that determine what is right and moral and good. The way of sin is a lie because it tells us that we are free and open to all possibilities, all the while hiding the fact that in sin we are in bondage. The way of sin also deludes us into thinking that we truly are the most important being in the universe. And it blinds us to how our actions affect others, how they affect even ourselves. The way of sin blinds us from seeing true reality. True reality is not about self-righteousness. It's not about having our act all together. It's not even about being good. True reality, the truest reality, is God himself. And it is into this reality that he invites us and welcomes us. The Lord wants to be in close relationship with us. And that's why God became human in Jesus, why he lived amongst us, why he died on the cross, so that our sins could be forgiven completely and fully, that we could be taken off the path of sin and brought to the path that leads to God, to bring us to himself, to fill us with his grace, and to give us life. Life in abundance that can come only through Jesus rising from the dead. Jesus is the purest and most complete expression of God's love and grace. Jesus is the truest reality as God in human form. Trusting Jesus and following him as Lord is the way of truth and hope and life. Choose the way of God, the way of Christ, and know his steadfast love. Know his righteousness, his righteousness. Know his judgments. Know the salvation that he gives to you in Jesus. Know him as your refuge. Feast on the abundance that he provides. Know the delight and joy of God. Know life as it is supposed to be. Lived with purpose beyond ourselves. Lived with meaning deeper than our possessions. Lived with abundance, but not in money. Lived with joy because it is lived in and with the Lord. The world is a dark place, and there is more evil in it than we as individuals will ever really know about. But we can trust in Jesus and follow the way of Christ and know the fullness of life that he gives us. Your love, O Lord, reaches to the heavens, and your faithfulness stretches to the sky. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, and your justice flows like the rolling tide. I will lift my voice to worship you, my King. I will find my strength in the shadow of your wings. Let's pray together. Our God, we thank you for the grace that you give to us in Jesus, the grace that is proved in the cross. We thank you that Jesus died for us, that he died for me to forgive my sins. I thank you that he rose from the dead, proving that his sacrifice was effective and efficient and did everything it was supposed to do. We thank you for all that you give to us, for the love and grace you give us, for the the faithfulness you live to us, that you are faithful to us every day. We thank you for the abundance you give us, the life that you give us in Jesus. We turn to you, Lord. We turn off of the path of sin and we turn to you, trusting in Jesus, trusting in your forgiveness in Jesus because of the cross. Draw us to yourself. Set our feet on your path to walk to you always. Our God, this day we pray for the people of Beirut and Lebanon. Because of this disaster this week, we pray for provision for people who have already been suffering far more than we have realized. We pray for provision, for food, for security. We pray for a good and healthy government for the people there. And close to home, Lord, we pray your grace and blessing upon Barb and Robert in the death of Barb's mom. We pray for your grace upon Joan and her family in the death of Don. We pray that you would comfort and bless and be present with those who grieve. We pray your blessing upon Betty and Len. And Lord, we pray your grace, blessing, and healing upon Heather. Be gracious, Lord. Reach out your hand and grant your healing. Our God, all these prayers we offer to you in Jesus' name. Amen.
As we continue with our last song, we're just so grateful that despite everything that happens in this world, that we have a God who sits on the throne and who reigns over all. So would you join us in this last song?
Thank you.
thank you for being with us today, for worshiping together with us. I pray that you would go knowing that the path before you, the best path, the only true path, is the path that leads to Jesus. Explore that path, look at that path, call upon the Lord, and follow his way. May the love of God the Father and the grace of our Lord Jesus and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be upon you now and always. Amen.
We pray that you have a blessed week.